Islam, 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 peace and hotel. Canaan Land Morris class, 17th of February, 2015. Want to send a big shout out to all the Moors worldwide that continue to wake up and come into this marvelous light that Nobu Juwali told the Moors that they will come into. We want to give high honors to the Prophet Nobu Juwali. We want to give honors to Allah for sending us a Prophet so that we can get ourselves in the right place mentally due to this mental slavery that we have still getting rid of. We want to give honors to the forerunner, Marcus Messiah Garvey, who, even though called his movement Negro, was teaching the Negro about nationhood, teaching the Negro about true unity, not the fake unity that you hear about in the conscious community, all these stateless people trying to come together, and then some Moors there, you know, pushing the stateless people to stay stateless and, you know, let's be unified, show that, you know, we can work together, crap like that. Right, tell all those stateless people who call themselves conscious, get cognizant, get a nationality, and stop playing games, because game time is over. Right, well, how about this? Practice time is over, it's game time. Right, not no practice anymore, it's time to show your skills, left hand and right hand layups, you know, not just your strong hand. Right, we'll start, as usual, with some readings from the Prophet Nobu Juwali so that we can be clear as to what Nobu Juwali wanted for the Moors, what he did for the Moors, what he told the Moors, and why it is important for us to honor this man for the great work that he did to get his people back into the constitutional fold of government. Now, Nobu Juwali made many statements and said many things. Some of the things that Nobu Juwali put out for the Moors, especially the leadership, was to make sure that the members are just as clear as the leadership is. The members weren't supposed to be left in the dark. The members weren't supposed to be finding out, you know, what Nobu Juwali said 8 years later. The people who came into the Moorish movement were supposed to get taught. And, you know, the fact that we have to make statements like Islam to the new Moors coming into this and all that proves that these jokers didn't do their job. And if they didn't do their job, that means that they pretty much resigned their posts. They left their posts. They abandoned their posts. And, you know, from a military perspective, abandoning your posts is, you know, you don't want to abandon your post. Just go ask the military Moors about abandoning posts. So Nobu Juwali gave the Moors some letters that he said to be read every meeting that wasn't read. So we, you know, based on you know, Moors being active, and then inspiring other Moors to be active, Moors have taken the position of bringing these letters back out so that the people can know. And Noble Drawley knew what was going on. He knew that there was a sellout. He knew that people were trying to assassinate him. And he knew that he can't really do the work from here. He's going to have to go to the Soul Plane to get a lot of the work that he really wanted to do done, because the people who were around him were Judases, majority of them, right? So a warning from the prophet to be read every meeting. I hereby inform all members that they must put an end to all radical and agitating speeches while on their jobs, homes, or on the public streets. We advocate peace and not destruction. Stop trying out your cards with the Europeans, for it causes confusion. There has been much confusion caused by members trying out their cards. The cards are for your salvation. Failure of obeying my orders will be of severe consequence. We are for love, truth, peace, freedom, and when these principles are violated, justice must then take its course. Any member or group of members that seek to hold malicious feelings toward the prophet, toward the temple or the prophet, or to violate the divine covenant of the Moorish movement will receive their reward from Allah for their unjust deeds. All true Moors must obey the laws laid down to them by their prophet, and if they lose confidence in their prophet, give up your card and button, cease wearing your turban or fez, and return to the state where I, the prophet, found you. For this is a holy and divine movement founded by the prophet Noble Drawley. And if the prophet is not right, the temple is not right. The prophet is sending out a divine plea to all true Moorish Americans that they may do their part in protecting their prophet and the temple. This is an everlasting movement founded by the prophet through the will of Allah to redeem his people from their sinful ways. Noble Drawley. Then we have to the members of the Moorish Science Temple of America. Islam, these are the instructions from your prophet Noble Drawley. Be faithful unto your forefathers' divine and national creed, that you will be blessed for your good deeds that you sow in the flesh. Allah is the one that judges the world, and his judgment is now on, but the weak comprehend it not. The end of time is drawing near. So Allah to his divine prophet, says Allah to his divine prophet, I, Noble Drawley, and that is why many hearts have turned to stone, and many have eyes to see, but cannot see, ears to hear but cannot hear, lest they would be confounded of their sins. These are trying hours now, dear Moors, and every evil spirit is moving, and they are trying every weak mind to overthrow and drag out the true foundation that has been laid, and to cause confusion in the minds of the ones that believe. If you have the true love of Allah and the spirit of your forefathers, you fear not what you hear or see, but you will sacrifice the utmost of your very life to protect your prophet and your movement. Watch your enemies, dear Moors. Your enemies are the ones that speak against your prophet and ridicule him to the very lowest, and the ones that speak against your divine and national principles of your temples. Act accordingly, and Allah will bless you for your good work. Peace, your divine prophet, Noble Drawley. And the other letter to be proclaimed every meeting. Islam, I am glad to know that I have a few faithful Moors among you all, and I desire for them to know the truth and the divine truth. There is a host of jealousy about me and the movement now by the same people of our side of the nation that claim it was only a joke and unreal. But now, since they have found out from the government officials and the nations of the earth that this is the only sole foundation that all Asiatics must depend upon for their earthly salvation as American citizens, they are working every scheme that they can to disqualify me, so they themselves may take charge of the situation. I have notified these things to you long ago in the past. It is through the faithful Moors that attribute to the movement and the uplifting fund. The ones that paid their divine respect to me and the movement will be remembered. That is why I am calling upon all faithful Moors to increase their faithfulness to me, your prophet, and your divine Moorish movement. I need finance and I need it badly. Never before have I needed finance so badly as I do at present, so I can shove aside the discord that is facing the nation. It all comes through jealousy because of my fame and nobility. The nations of the world will not recognize the movement without I, the prophet, being head. It has been proven by my works, which I have performed in the last few years. So those were the readings that were supposed to be read every meeting that these Moors didn't read. And because they didn't read those meetings, now we're here 100 years later having to read these letters to new Moors coming into this information, when new Moors are supposed to be old Moors because their mom, dad, granddad, uncle, aunt, great aunt, sister, brother, whoever in their family was supposed to be Moorish American by now, so that they would be born Moors, they would be born into knowing what business is, knowing how to start businesses, knowing how to enforce the Constitution, knowing how to sue all these people for violating their rights instead of marching, picketing, and all this stuff that they're doing. They would have known everything that they had to know. But as we know, there was a sellout in the Moorish movement, and people on our side of the nation that claim it was only a joke and unreal sided with the Inquisition forces and got the prophet out of the way in order to control everything that the prophet laid down for the Moors, no different than CMB, right? When he got out the way, people came in, infiltrated, took over the stuff, played ownership with things that are the people's stuff. And the people, you know, it's like the saying of evil men get away with stuff because good men just sit there, watch them do evil stuff and don't do nothing about it. You know, Moors see dirty Moors. Moors know who dirty Moors are, but they're still playing the game, friendship game with them, like their stuff, you know, watch their videos, you know what I mean, share their videos, and, you know, that's giving them publicity instead of, you know, using your influence to beat the head in of these people so that other people could see, hey, those guys over there got their ass kicked. I guess it's not about doing what they did. So when Moors start being active, because, you know, being conscious that you're Moors, being, you know, I'm not Negro, black, colored, I'm Moors, and then leave it right there. That's not doing anything for anybody, right? The objective of this is for individuals who have this information, individuals who know this, your duty and your obligation is to make sure you tell somebody who doesn't know. But remember, if you can't convince them that they're not Negro, black, colored, African, whatever other fictions that they want to call themselves, once you put it to them and you can't convince them, then you could stop talking to them. Then you could not worry about telling them anything. But we have to take that initial step. Moors with this information. I don't care what degree of this information you got. Once you know that you're not Negro, black, colored, and you're sure of that, I don't care if you're in a temple, out of a temple, you belong to some organization that calls itself Moorish, whatever, right? Once you're on this path, your duty is to get off the path, go into the bushes where these people are walking around in bushes, talking about they know the way, they have the truth, the light, or whatever like that. Lead them to the path and see if they're going to get down the path. If they want to stay in the bushes, then let them do bushes. It's all right. You know what I mean? At least we can say that we tried. You know what I mean? Because eventually, They're gonna realize that those bushes not just grass. That's like we call it back in the islands, that's pica bush, you know, bush with thorns, right? So if they wanna walk in pica bush, that's up to them. Right? That's their skin. Right? Make sure when you go in those bushes that you got your, you know, knee high boots, long sleeve, you know what I'm saying? So you're not getting injured when you go into those jurisdictions to try or attempt to bring your people onto the straight and narrow, right? We have been very good, I must say, you know, at active Moors, you know, Moors who study, studious Moors. We have been good at getting people to come onto the path. As you know, we had the little Skype class with sister from the UK. She connected with some other Moors who seen that, and then, you know, connected with Cujo. You know, you need to contact with that sister or whatever like that, because we're out here and Moors are starting to come together in whatever jurisdiction that they're in. They're beginning to come together. They're beginning to realize that this is birthright. This is not clubism. This is not, you know, you have to belong temple to be Moors and all that, you know, because of the great work that's being done by active Moors. Nobu Jawali told the Moors that the press is our greatest weapon. The greatest weapon that we have is our press. And this weapon is supposed to be used any chance that we get, because it's our greatest weapon. Nobu Jawali said that. So all these active Moors that are out here, we have to be doing things that allow the information that we have to be getting out to the people in ways that we don't have to engage them personally. So we got Moors that have websites set up. We got Moors that are putting out literature, books, papers, pamphlets, flyers. We have Moors that are using social media, posting things on social media, whether it's videos, whether it's screenshots of Black's Law Dictionary words or whatever like that, to get this word out to the people. That's an obligation that we have as Moors, because, you know, Moors know that we're, you know, we got superior info. You know what I mean? We're not, you know, high horsing, you know, but, you know, we do have superior information. You know what I mean? We don't have the regular information like all these other guys have that they're pushing. Moors have a different level of information. Moors have information that when presented, it causes our people who are unconscious of the Moorish paradigm to consider it, even if it's a little bit. You know, it's like a brother, one of the brothers out here, good brother, he got a Nobu Jawali award this way, this year, and he called me on three-way with a young brother, and the brother called with regard to UCC. He heard about UCC, you know, straw man, redemption, BS. And, you know, the brother said, you know, I could direct you to some people, you know what I mean, who could, you know, give you some info on that. You know what I mean? It turned out to be a class for both of them, you know, because, you know, I already know how Moors do, right? At the end of the conversation, the brother was completely off of UCC, right? Was going to take some time to do some more studying, find out a little bit more about this so that he doesn't get, you know, played trying to claim some stuff that he shouldn't be claiming, right? Which leads us to today's class. Claim your birthright, not houses and mansions and whatever else, buildings or whatever that, you know, people think that that's what this is about. No different than, you know, a few years ago, you know, that thing was right to travel. Oh yeah, be a more so I could right to travel. I don't need a license. And then people getting their ass kicked by these highwaymen who know that they have a right to travel, but you know, because people are acting premature, they get themselves caught up because, you know, we're not the ones with the jails. We're not the ones with the handcuffs. We're not the ones with the pepper spray. And we're not the ones that have, you know, paid highwaymen out there abusing people's rights. So we want Moors to now put it out there. We're not saying don't make claims. We're not saying don't claim houses, right? We're saying understand the truth about your nationality and your birthrights. Because if you don't understand the truth about your nationality and birthrights, anything that you claim is probably going to get taken anyways because, you know, you aren't ready. And Moors, the brainwash, the mind control, the mental slavery that we were under, the mind control that we were under before we came into this, doesn't go away just because you say, I'm Moor. It doesn't go away just because you say, I'm Moorish American. I proclaim my nationality. Here's my paper. Here's my card. We still have brainwash. I still have brainwash. So if I know that I got brainwashed, then guarantee people out there still got brainwash that they haven't removed yet. And this is half of why people get caught up in things that they shouldn't be caught up in, right? Now, they had article came out on Friday the 13th. A woman tries to kick owners out of $4.7 million Chesterfield mansion. Now, my question is to these Moors who, you know, like to go claim stuff that's not theirs, you know, because remember, you know, we're not saying don't claim. We are saying that you better know what you're doing. Because if you don't know what you're doing, they're the ones that have the jails. They're the ones that have the handcuffs. They're the ones that have the cars that they can put you in. They're the ones that have the mercenaries that work for them that are paid to violate your rights. They're not paid to serve and protect people. They're paid to make sure that the people don't get this government off their back that's pretending to be legitimate. My question is, with these claimers of stuff, want to go claim stuff, right? There was an article from July 6, 2012. City of Ghosts. Haunting abandoned buildings of St. Louis after city's population fell by 70% in a century. With boarded up windows, peeling paint, and crumbling bricks, these deserted St. Louis buildings have been long forgotten. Residents seem to have fled years ago, and the dilapidated properties now serve as a bleak reminder of Missouri City's declining population, struggling industry. However, one local photographer keen to highlight the problems facing Gateway City is now drawing attention to the abandoned buildings. This is 2 years ago, right? Now, here's a mansion. Abandoned. How come Moors don't go claim this? When I called City of St. Louis, City of St. Louis, they said that they have about 600,000 dollars, fiat dollars, worth of abandoned properties that are just sitting there. And this is just in a little jurisdiction. It's not even the whole city. This is just a portion of the jurisdiction. And this is just St. Louis only. Right? So imagine all these other places out here with all these properties that are so-called abandoned, that Moors don't want to go claim these, because, you know, if you claim these, you got to work. Now, greedy Moors that want to go claim mansions that people are in, and mansions that, you know, all these so-called real estate agents, banks or whatever, make claims on already, are letting these ones just sit there. When you can go down to the office, deeds office, whatever, whoever, whatever the jurisdiction is that deals with the deeds and properties, and they'll give you a list of all the properties that are abandoned, where they are, how long they've been abandoned, and all that. If you want to claim something, either claim the house that you're in right now, paying a mortgage on, fraudulent mortgage, or claim these. Any Moors that you hear about going and claiming mansions and houses that, you know, aren't quote-unquote abandoned, they're out for their own little selfish game. Leave those Moors alone. Justice will catch them. Abandoned. This right here. Raccoons got this on lock right now. You know, and whatever else wants to make this their home. Just because Moors aren't claiming. Boy, this is, and remember, this is just St. Louis. Okay? Abandoned. All these Moors out here talking about they could do this, they could do that. Why don't you claim some of these, fix these up, instead of go claiming stuff that people have jurisdiction over. And then when you get kidnapped for claiming some stuff that people already make claims on, I don't care whether it's legitimate claims, illegal claims, whatever. There's no need to be claiming something that somebody has when they have all these abandoned properties all over the place. They got properties that you can just pay the taxes and get them. They got properties for $1, $5 that you can put down and get just because they've been abandoned, sitting there, and city wants to get rid of them. How about claim some of these stuff if you want to exercise your birthrights? If you want to exercise writs of possession? Don't be claiming stuff that's people already in and furnished. How about claim some of these stuff, fix them up, right? Just like stick-up kids, and get people out of their Negro black crap that they're in. Guarantee you, if you can claim some of these and fix these up and give people affordable housing and get them off Section 8 and get them off welfare and have them living in these that we fix up, bet you there'll be Moors tomorrow. Guarantee there'll be Moors. They'll immediately proclaim their nationality, because they'll what? See that Moors are actually humanitarian. They'll see that Moors actually care about their people. Look at these stuff. Just go online and just Google abandoned properties. And whatever so-called corporate state. And you'll see some properties that Moors should be claiming. And again, these are for all those Moors who like to make claims on stuff. Who don't want to study, who don't want to, you know, they just want to go out and you know, exercise birthrights because they heard about it. Okay, exercise your birthright and go claim some of these stuff instead of claiming mansions that people are in already, right? We'll claim some of these. You know how many people we could put in some of these? Fix them up. How are we gonna fix them up? Don't worry. Claim them and we'll deal with that after. And again, majority of these properties, they are not in as bad a shape as they appear. Right? Think about it, Morris. You claim some of these stuff. You claim some of these and give people some affordable housing, guaranteed there'll be Morris immediately. And half of these properties are already in the hood and all that stuff. So, you know, it's not like people don't know that they're there. They pass by them every day. You know, they don't have knowledge to go claim them. So, you know, we should. And then we do some humanitarian work, get the word out to the people about the power of nationality and birthrights so that we can make some more leeway, because we're making leeway, you know what I mean? But some more's activity is selfish, and we need to get out of the selfish mindset and start thinking about, you know, people who are less fortunate. You know, and this is just St. Louis. Once again, just to put it out there, this is just St. Louis. And all these are abandoned. All these are properties that the so-called city gave up on. They don't even care. You want to do something? You want to be active? Don't try right to travel. Don't go claim mansion, that whatever. Hit up the city where you're at. Find out where the abandoned properties are. Claim them. And fix them up. And let's help out some less fortunate people. Because it could be done. You know what I mean? If you can, you know, think about when Moors go claim the mansion. And you know, Moors have gotten them. There's some Moors who have gotten, you know, they're not talking. But there's Moors who have made claims on properties that are furnished and whatever like that and got them. What if we did that same thing, you know, and again, quote unquote, writs of possession, you know, just Google it, you know, they'll come up, put your national flag on it, you know, put your stuff on it, and, you know, make claims. Think about what we could do with some of these. Just think about if the Moors fix these up. Because remember, these are abandoned, right? Negro black colored leaders, they're not doing nothing with these. They're not claiming these, you know, because they got their check. So, you know, they are funded by the state so they can, you know, get the furnished stuff, you know, that they're going to pay rent on or whatever. But we can own some of these outright. We could own some of these, you know. You don't have a temple in your area? Oh, how about claim some of these, right? Get with, you know, there's ample Moors out there who are qualified. You know, even if you don't want to say Moorish Science Temple, say Moorish whatever building, come here, learn the truth about your nationality and birthrights, paint Noble Jwali on the building, all that stuff, and, you know, let's really get real. Because we're real. You know what I mean? It's not like, you know. And like I'm saying, that's for Moors who are on that. Moors who are on that level of, you know, the activity. Moors who are on the level of making claims. Right? Right? Boarded up stuff. They don't have too many out here, but I know for a fact that all these states or whatever, every time we go, we always say, damn, look at all these just abandoned stuff. One after the other, just going down the street for like 10 blocks, one after the other, abandoned, boarded up, boarded up, boarded up, boarded up. grass coming out the window, grass on the steps, grass growing on the building, plants making claims, and Moore's talking about, you know, how come this and how come we can't that and why don't we have stuff? How about you go claim some stuff and let's have stuff? It could be done. It's not far-fetched. Because why? Because these are abandoned. And then think about the respect that Moors will get. Think about the level of respect that Moors would get if they go into some of these communities, claim these abandoned properties, fix them up, and, you know, we can even be jerks and just give them to people. Just pick somebody in the hood. Oh yeah, that lady, she's been living here for 50 years or whatever. Give her the spot. Claim another one. Oh yeah, that family right there, they've been on welfare for however long. Give them the spot. All they got to do is pay their light bill. Water. If that. You know. So we just wanted to put it out there. So that Morris could just, you know, consider. You know, I just thought the name of that for the class was cool. That's why, that's not really what we're going to be dealing with today. That was just, you know, 2 minutes talk just to put some stuff out there. It was a cool statement. Don't claim your birthright, not houses. So, next thing. As Morris, no, we're just putting this out there. So that people can consider. Indian government extremely disturbed by rough treatment of grandfather by Alabama police. So we already know about, you know, the morning walk, February 6, 2015, turned into an international incident when Madison police injured 57-year-old Sureshbhai Patel after neighbors in the quiet middle-class neighborhood reported a suspicious man. The incident reverberated around the world among Indian expatriates, has prompted local Indian groups to call for more cultural education for police officers.
I'll just get him out there.
Let's get him, give him his little props. You know what I mean? In the hospital.
Okay,
broken tailbone or some crap like that. Because, and if you see the video, dude got tackled. And he's like 57 or whatever. Like, he got tackled. He got tackled. You know how they are. You know what I mean? He got the super tackle.
It was on people.
Right? Now, this is for us to use for all of our Negro, black, colored friends out there. Want to go march, picket. You know what I mean? For rights. You know, have all CIA agents talking on their behalf. You know what I mean? Hiring lawyers who can't get an indictment yet. All right? Just to see the power of nationality. Because, you know, Moore's already know. But our people need to be inspired. You know? So we'll inspire them a bit. All right? The Indian government is extremely disturbed by the treatment of a 57-year-old grandfather from that country who was roughed up by police while walking in a suburban neighborhood in Alabama. Syed Akbaruddin, a spokesman for India's External Affairs Ministry, said the government took the incident very seriously and was in contact with U.S. mission in New Delhi. The government also will contact officials in Washington and Alabama. Akbaruddin said in response to reporters' questions in New Delhi about the treatment of Sureshbhai, pronounced Sureshbhai, in the Tennessee Valley city of Madison. What we will communicate is that we are extremely disturbed, he said. This is a matter of concern for us, And India and the US, as open pluralist societies, need to address these issues and find ways in a mature manner so that these are aberrations and are not the norm. So all these guys who said that they came over here on a slave ship or whatever, right? Black History Month, you know.
Oh yeah, February.
February. How come none of these places where they claim that they came from, how come those government officials aren't talking to Washington and talking to, you know, state of and city of whoever?
Nigeria's not repping, you know, them, right? Or South, you know, Africa's,
Ghana's
not
coming.
Or,
nobody's coming. No one's writing coming. Letters
Ethiopia's
or nothing like
not
that. Nobody's saying say anything about
Liberia,
them getting shot
Liberia's
up.
Nigeria's not coming to
nothing.
See them.
Zero. Zero.
Zero.
How come? Because, as we know, Moors, stateless people don't have rights. Stateless people aren't respected by the international community, because the international community had a convention on statelessness, and the international community told stateless people. So, the Indian man, and remember, keep in mind, the Indian man from India. So anybody who calls yourself Indian over here, those guys are running a fraud. This is broad statelessness that they're addressing right now with this one Indian man.
This one gentleman.
They're talking about Negro, Black, color people who are running a fraud, talking to them. They're talking about the so-called people call themselves Indian. They got tax cards from, you know, government of Canada, government of the United States, or whatever, like, claiming they have natives, but they're Indian. But this is not India. But they're Indian. But then the man came from India to here, got injured, and they're addressing him as Indian. Calling him Indian, the Indian man. The Indian man that got whatever. And nobody is thinking, you know, the native. The 57-year-old native that got beat up by the police, tackled or whatever. Nobody's not thinking that. When they say Indian, they're talking about a man from India. Schooling everybody.
Understand.
Right? But they're not going there. But it's okay. I mean, it's quite okay. That's just stuff to put out there. Just so we're clear. Amar posted this one, which was pretty interesting. Bao Zhengbei of the Song Dynasty. So here's the brother. Here's the brother. Song Dynasty. No crescent moon tattoo or something on his forehead or something like that. Born or something like that with some crescent moon on his forehead. Which you know, qualified him to be the head of the whatever, because you know, he was born with the mark of you know, the mark of the stuff. Right? Asiatics. Okay. Asiatics. Orientals. You know, not Occidentals, Orientals.
Occidentals.
Right? Orientals. Asiatics. That people say they don't want to be. And just to, you know, so people are clear that we're talking about a brother. You know, here's the mask that they made of him, and it's a black mask or whatever, right? You know, just
in,
so people
in
know.
Asia?
Yeah.
Okay, they made this.
Yeah, like the black mask.
The quote unquote, the yellow
not
guy.
Not a yellow guy, not a yellow mask. Or orange mask, or, you know, pale mask. A black mask to represent him. Just to show people, you know, that Moore's been everywhere.
With the headdress.
Right, has the headdress, the jewel on the forehead, all that stuff. Same culture all over the world.
Mm-hmm.
Jewel on the forehead, right? Dark skin. You know, look at the nose. Look at the nose, so you know. They're not lying. They're telling us what's up. Right? We also, this is for all the black guys, Negro, colored, African, clowns. Want to talk about the Moors stole from the Turks and stuff like that. You know, even though we put it on the record already.
We've been through this.
You know, we've been through this, but, you know, we continue to beat them in the head with the truth just because what else are we going to do with truth? You know what I mean? But beat these people in their head. They want to go debate at Alhambra ballrooms and stuff like that about who's better. You know, they want to go on video, you know, talking about that, you know, yeah, you know what I mean, this is unity event, you know what I mean, and all of us came together, you know, the black guys, and then the Hebrews, and then the this guys, and all these guys are here, and then we're all here together, and this is unity. That's not unity, that's goddamn fraud, because half those people don't have a nationality. Half of them have a license in their pocket that they got from the so-called white man who's their enemy, that they talk about that's their enemy. But they have his license in their pocket and they're paying him taxes, right? But don't want to recognize that they're running a fraud. And then going to charge Moors with running a fraud when, you know, reclaiming properties and stuff like that. Moors got their own plates and all that stuff and they don't want to get down with that. Why? Because they fear their God, the European, the white man. Fear him. They fear him. All these posers, all these guys gonna go to the range, you know what I mean? Shoot at targets in their stuff, you know what I mean? They got the, you know what I mean? The big guns, you know? They can pose good, you know? They can pose good. The camera's on them.
Yeah.
Well, they can pose good. But time to go deal with this European's case with those guns that they got. They're not going to deal with anybody playing games.
We'll take selfies with the
guns. Oh, yeah, take selfies with guns and stuff like that. Shoot their brother up, shoot their sister up, shoot children in cribs, and shoot children drive-by shootings, missing who they're aiming for or whatever, hitting innocent bystanders. But all these so-called, you know, mercenaries out here violating people's rights, oh, no, they don't do nothing about that. You know, they're just going to let them do what they do. So, Aguz Khan, you're going to look up Aguz Khan, O-G-U-Z, Khan, K-H-A-N. That's the man who all Turkish tribes come from.
Okay.
Right?
That's the one guy.
The name Aguz means ones from space. Right? So, here's the spaceman right here.
Uh-huh.
Got his scimitar.
Uh-huh.
Right?
Uh-huh.
Got his bow. Got his arrows.
Crescents in his hand, yo.
Got his moon.
Turban up.
Got his turban, right? Don't
see
forget.
See the design on the turban right there?
Okay, well, the design on the turban, don't forget. That comes from Kemet.
Angelina Jolie
right?
Stealing
yep.
shit.
Right?
Straight stealing shit.
Right? You know, the Moor, you know, running on the Moors and all that stuff, you know. Right? Right from Kemet. Don't forget. It's all the same culture all over the world. But these people don't want to be their self. They want to be Negroes. They want to be black guys. They want to be everything except who their ancient foremother and forefathers were. Right? This is the founder of the... All the Turkic tribes come from him. Ogun Khan. Right? Ogun.
The one from space.
From space. The spaceman. The spaceman Moor.
Interesting just to give someone that name to begin with.
You know? Playing games. And then we just have to put this one out there just so people can, you know that the fraud's going on. You know? There's the Nation of Islam under Fard Muhammad. Everybody got their fezzes on. There's Fard up there. And then you see right here, Prophet Fard. I thought Fard Muhammad was Allah according to Elijah Muhammad. How come Fard is a prophet here? So Fard's a prophet when he started the stuff, but that by the time Elijah Muhammad came, Fard became Allah. And then Elijah Muhammad came, you guys, prophet. And then they said that they're a nation.
Crown and lost and found brothers.
Lost and found brothers. You know, and then you can see freedom right there. You know they jacked that. You see justice right there. You know they jacked that. You know where they jacked that from. But they would never ever give the man his props by telling all those people in the Nation of Islam proclaim their nationality. Even though, you know, they all had fezzes early and stuff. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? They all had fezzes. They all were down with. They all were yeah, down with
they
it.
Were down.
It's not they weren't down with it. They were down with it.
They were down on the program.
Right? Down on the program. All of a sudden, nobody's not down with the program anymore. Right? They got a newspaper. They kept that part of the bargain up. Why? Nobody's really said. The press is our greatest weapon. Mm-hmm. So they got their newspaper. They got their little boys out there, you know, selling, giving people papers, get donations, blah, blah, you know, all this stuff. Right? Mm-hmm. So that lets you know as well about the frauds on our side that said it was only a joke and unreal. If they say that they're more Science Temple of America and they don't have a newspaper, they're a fraud. Remember that. Because Drew Ali said the paper, the press, is our greatest weapon. And also, and when more start talking about, oh yeah, make sure you get, you know, Black's Law Dictionary, and they don't tell you what edition to get. They tell you get Black's Law Dictionary. They don't tell you 4, 3, 2, and 1 only. Don't get anything after 4. They're a fraud.
They want edition 10.
12, yeah, they want right. They all these editions with that are colored. They want all these editions that are abridged, right?
Oh, the abridged version.
Yeah, they want the abridged version, right? Press.
Oh yeah.
In old practice, a piece or skin of parchment, several of which used to be sewed together. In making up a roll or record of proceedings, a piece or skin of parchment. So, and then when you do your research on all the old books, they tell you, you know, stuff had skin as covers. Right? Before they started using hemp as paper, they were using people as paper. Metaphorically, the aggregate of publications issued from the press, or the giving publicly to one's sentiments and opinions through the medium of printing, as in the phrase liberty of the press. So, Canaan Land Moores is a distributor of Moorish Masonic Gate, which is press. Every single temple should have this. Every single temple should be contacting Brother Abdullah El Talib Mosey Bey to have the Masonic Gate newspaper in their temple in order to qualify themselves to be a legitimate Moorish Science Temple of America if they don't have a Moorish guidepost. Newspaper. If they don't have their own paper, they should connect with Moors who have a paper, subscribe to them. But, you know, we also have, you know, just to put it out there, you know, we also have the flyer that we give out, you know, to let everybody know that the Masonic Gate, which is available online at MoorsCivilLetter.net, is now distributed in Canaan Land. So nobody could say that we're not following what Noble Drew Ali said. Nobody could say that. They could talk crap on social media or whatever, but I guarantee you, if you ask those Moors talking crap about Kudrow, where's their newspaper? You know, crickets. If you ask those Moors, you know, where's their press? Where's their literature? Right? By Grand Sheik Kudrow, crickets. They can't show you their stuff that they're putting out. And if they show you stuff, they'll show you one thing. Oh yeah, we put out a book, so that means we're legitimate. Forget the one book. We got so much info as Moors. Everybody who says that they're Moors, that's ahead of a temple, should have about 5, 10, 15, 20 different stuff out there just because, you know, Noble Drew Ali said. In order to change the people, change their literature. Anybody who calls themselves grand whatever, and they have a sign on a building called Moore Science Temple, if all they got in there is Holy Quran, 101 questionnaire, Moorish literature, and that's it, and none of those heads in there don't have any literature out, those guys are a fraud. Don't even waste your time, right? So you can go, and then don't forget that we have our own people that are publishing our stuff. We're not going to know somebody. You know what I mean? We have Moors. Moorish Guide Publishing Company that publishes our stuff. Why? Because Noble Drew Ali put that in order. Noble Drew Ali set that up. KhalifaMedia.com, you can go get that stuff there, right? And then there it is again, another book by Kudrow. Right? And there it is again, and then another book by Kudrow. Okay? And then don't forget, we also have our own newspaper. Right? If you want to subscribe to the newspaper, send an email, Canaan Land Guide. You know, that's why the email is called Canaan Land Guide, because it's the Moorish Guide. Okay? If Moors don't have those stuff, they're a fraud. Don't even pay them any attention. Right? And then remember, RV Bay Publications, they got ample amounts of literature there. Because same thing, Noble Drew Ali said, in order to change people, you must change their literature. Right? Don't forget. Right? Grand Sheikh Messiah, who's locked up right now, he got stuff. Oh, you want to help him out? Make sure you go buy his books.
So if a dude in jail is pumping books.
If right? Right? He's not even out here. And he got stuff up. Right? Holy Moorish Emporium. .org. Okay? And he doesn't have one. He has another one.
Don't got one.
Doesn't have one. He will, right? He has another one. Who are the Moors? Grand Chief Messiah. Okay? Holy Moorish Emporium. Just Google that and go support the Moor, because you could use the support. Mm. Trust me, you could use the support.
And where are they currently holding them hostage?
He's in New Jersey.
New Jersey, okay.
Yeah. Right? Well, don't forget my good brother out in the Bay Area. Another Moor, you know, just realize, hey, you know, we don't have anything out there, mm-hmm. So maybe we should put something out there, right? Mm-hmm. And once again, you know, Khalifa Media, once again, putting it out there. So don't say that we can't, you know, what do the Moors got? You know, what do the Moors got? How come the Moors don't got? We got publishing stuff, we got books and all that. What we need right now, what we need a building for when it's only going to be, you know, five of us in there talking about Islam, Moors, because the job is to go wake up our people. Our obligation is to wake up our people. We're supposed to be waking up our people. We're supposed to be bringing our people into this. We're not supposed to be playing like, you know, this is for Moors only and nobody else could get down with this unless, you know, they say that they're Moors and all that stuff.
Join
the club to be down. You know, pay their little entry fee. And then now they're whatever, right? Okay, Moors Leaders' Historical Message to America. In connection with the aims, objectives, rules, and regulations of the Moorish Science Temple of America, I deem it proper to submit to you a brief statement of our organization covering its inception, rise, and progress of the Mohammedan religion, which I hope will be satisfactory to you and be the means of causing you at all times to adhere to the principles of love, truth, peace, freedom, and justice in your relations with mankind. Not in your relations with temple members.
Just your crew.
Not relations with only people with fezzes on. With mankind. Because everybody's fallen right now. Everybody's in a state of... Everybody's in a state of not knowing right now. Even people who claim to know don't know. Right? And they don't know because the prophet, Noble Drew Ali, has been put on the back, you know, put on the back. When he's supposed to be up front, been supposed to be up front, regardless of what they claim, call themselves, whatever, or not, they, just right on the TV stand there, you'll see them. Right? He has been put so far back. That's why we give honors to, you know what I mean, like Moors who put the prophet up front. They don't even care about themselves. They put themselves on the back. They don't even care about going on the front. They put the prophet up front. They put Noble Drew Ali up front. Giving him his accolades that he well earned. Mankind, I further most anxiously hope this brief statement will help you to be more clearly, help you to more clearly see the duty and wisdom of at all times upholding those fundamental principles which are desired for our civilization of our posterity, such as obedience to law, respect and loyalty to government, tolerance and unity. We organized as the Moorish Temple of Science in the year 1925, and we were legally incorporated as a civic organization under the laws of the state of Illinois, November 29th, 1926. But then all these hallelujah, praise Allah Moors are not going to help people when they get a ticket. They're going to tell them go pay tickets, yeah. Not fight it. They're going to tell them go pay taxes. Yeah. They're going to tell them follow the laws of the state and all this stuff. When Article 6 tells you that, Article 6 of the Constitution tell you if any laws of the state are contrary to the Constitution, it does not stand that law. And grand sheiks and governors and secretaries and whoever are in power to make law and enforce law. And the only law that they're enforcing is state policy. Those guys are a fraud. The name Moorish Temple of Science was changed to Moorish Science Temple of America. 1928, in accordance with the legal requirements of the Secretary of State of Illinois. The object of our organization is to help in the great program of uplifting fallen humanity and teach those things necessary to make our members better citizens. A national organization with a Rotarian complexion as it relates to branch temples became obvious with the increasing number of inquiries from men and women in different sections of the country concerning the purpose of the organization. There are branch temples in 15 different states at this time. Since the work of the Moorish Science Temple of America was largely religious, the organization has been legally changed to a religious corporation, and an affidavit to this effect has been properly filed in Cook County Recorder Office of Illinois. Now, even though the work of the Moorish Science Temple of America was largely religious, so the organization has been legally changed to a religious corporation, religion is a part of Constitution. Religion doesn't stand on its own by itself. Religion is Constitution, which means that even the Moorish Science Temple of America is supposed to be dealing with civics and constitutional law and teaching constitutional law. And if they're not doing that, those guys are a fraud. Don't even pay them any attention. They talk all this religious stuff and all that, and that's it. And they're not telling you about constitutional, then you already know that they are running a fraud. Okay? The Morris Science Temple of America has received some opposition and criticism. In the main, the opposition has come from certain Christian ministers. They have expressed themselves as being opposed to our propagation of the Mohammedan religion, possibly because the promotion of Mohammedan faith among our people in the United States is considered by them in terms as something new. Whatever the reasons may be for their opposition, the legal right to oppose citizens, individuals, and organizations alike for their religious beliefs does not exist in the United States. Whatever the reason may be for their opposition, the legal right to oppose citizens, individuals, and organizations alike for their religious belief does not exist in the United States. The door of religious freedom made by the American Constitution swings open to all, and people may enter through it and worship as they desire. Without religious freedom, which is constitutional, no search for truth would be possible. Without religious freedom, no discovery of truth would be useful. Without religious freedom, religious progress would be checked, and we would no longer march forward toward the noble life which the future holds for the races of men. Without religious freedom, there would be no inspiration to lift our heads and gaze with fearlessness into the vast beyond, seeking a hope eternal. It is a sad weakness in us, after all, to oppose our fellow men for their religious beliefs. And if there are angels who record the sorrows of men as well as their sins, they certainly know how many and deep are the useless sorrows that spring forth from such opposition. Possibly love and time will cancel our hatreds in the regard and prove that in mankind, tolerance is better than unwarranted opposition. In connection with our religious aims and beliefs, we must promote economic security. The preaching of economic security among us is by no means as widespread and intensive as the circumstances demand. No other one thing is more needed among us at this time than greater economic power. But then, you know, when Moors talk about, you know, pay your dues and all this type of stuff, you know, Moors want to say that, you know, Moors are robbing stuff and trying to steal money out of this and pocketing stuff like that. But, you know, they're not going to charge. Yeah, they're not going to charge the ones who's charging packages. Right? Not going to go at them. But they're going to come at the good Moors who are asking for a little bit of support.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So that we can keep this activity up that we're doing that costs them. Right? Yeah. We shall be secure in nothing until we have economic power. A beggar people cannot develop the highest in them, nor can they attain to a genuine enjoyment of the spiritualities of life. Who's the beggar people? The beggar people are all these Grant people. All these so-called Negro, Black, colored organizations, whatever, that want to take the position of, you know, let's go to the enemy, who we know is the enemy, and go get them to give us some fiat so that we can build this and we can have that and we can, you know, fund whatever that we have to get. When it's, this is the people stuff. And Mudrali told the Moors, I need, you know, it's the same letter to be read every meeting. I need finance and I need it badly. Never before have I needed finance so badly as I do at present, so I can shove aside the discord that is facing the nation. Not shove aside the discord that's facing the Moorish Science Temple, the Moorish Movement, Moorish Divine National Movement, Moorish Holy Temple of Science, the discord that is facing the nation. That's why we put it out there. You want to make some donations to Canaan Land Moors? You know, dollar, $2 or whatever, every little bit helps in keeping us to do this work that has been neglected for 100 years, right? And, you know, it's not a begging thing, because as far as Canaan land, Morris Science Temple is concerned, the Morris who are in the head of that, or the head of this, they put out fiat to make sure that this stuff, whatever, they'll go hungry to make sure Noble Drew Ali gets his props. Just because, right? Just on the weekend, we'll put together and we'll buy food in bulk and give everybody a little piece, opposed to everybody taking whatever fiat and spending so we could eat. Forget that. Your profit is cut, whatever's left over, we'll buy whatever and we'll split that up so that everybody has a little something, right? Because it's not that, it's not that we need the fiat, because, you know, this is our estate. You know what I mean? Land is worth more than fiat. Nationality is worth more than fiat. You know what I mean? Religion is worth more than fiat. Knowing that we have a prophet is worth more than any fiat anybody could give. Knowing that I'm not Negro, black, colored is worth more than me having some fiat. You know what I mean? Because guaranteed you can take your nationality and you can go somewhere with it, and somebody would hit you off just because you have a nationality. Somebody. We already told Morris about going to the store, putting on the card, and people giving us food for free. Just because. And people say, no, here, take extra. Don't worry, anytime. Just come back to the store, go in the fridge. Don't even worry about paying for nothing. You're the native people of this land. I know that you're the native of this land. You don't have to pay for nothing. You know what I mean? Don't worry. You know what I mean? But because we haven't been mourned for so long, you know, people are, they don't know. Should we not give it? Whatever, right?
A lot of catching up to you. People gotta get up with the times.
We're at that place. We're at that place right now where, you know, look, all the people who even aren't Christian are sympathetic to these 21 Orthodox that got beheaded or whatever by some demons. You know what I mean? Talking about their Islamic whatever. That ain't no Islam. Islam ain't beheading people and all that stuff. That's the same stuff that got Moors in the crap that they're in right now, why they got to pay taxes to Rome, why they got to do all this stuff, because they violated natural law. Have no respect for other people's religion. Same thing Noble Drew Ali just told the Moors. Right? But remember, you know, that's American Constitution. Everywhere else in the world, people shit on other people's religion. They don't care. That's why everybody's coming here, because they know that over the stuff over here is founded on some principles. And the only reason that stuff goes down here is because the individuals here want to play stateless. Remember, we showed y'all the Indian man. You know what I mean? Showed y'all the Indian man. Guarantee the Indian man has a religion. Guarantee. He's not just atheist or whatever.
No matter what it is, he has one.
Guarantee he has one. You know? Talking about they seen a suspicious man walking, so they called police or whatever. He's 57. Like, what? And you see the man walking, you know? Like, the man's walking. Just a man walking. Like, what do you mean he's a threat to people or whatever? You call Popo.
No record. No history.
Right? We're going to switch up a bit. We're going to read a little bit from another, once again, you know what I mean, putting out the literature, right? Hip Hop Decoded, big up to the Black Doc, you know, who has his little album, hip hop album out. He freely says Mars on his album, you know what I mean? He's not secretive about it or whatever. He knows what's up, right? This is chapter 4, Agents of the Matrix. The year is 2006, and on every corner of every hood and back road throughout the United States, there are potential agents everywhere. These potential agents pose a great threat to anyone who is in possession or still has access to real hip hop. Right, so we're gonna, just like Brother Dawid was teaching us, right? We're gonna, when we read things that aren't written by quote unquote nationalized Moors, we're gonna replace everything in there with words so that it relates to us from a Moorish perspective, so that we can get a full grasp of what is being said. Because majority of people, they say real good stuff, but because they don't say Moors, you know, hybrids, Albions, or whatever like that, you know what I mean? They're black people, white people, you know, they talk, you know, they talk distorted.
Yeah.
The message gets distorted, right? It has become such a rare commodity that one must move anonymously amongst these programmed hip-hoppers for fear that if their true identity and beliefs are revealed, they will most certainly be attacked by agents in training, driven by the Matrix to believe that the latest version of shit hop downloaded into our thought stream is our salvation. Okay? So as soon as you start really getting on Moorish science for what it is, you start really studying Moorish nationality and birthrights for what it is, immediately you're going to realize how many people around you are agents. And they're against the real foundation of what being a Moor really is. As soon as you start, you're going to start realizing that a lot of these people are trying to own people's birthrights, sell people's birthrights to them. A lot of these people are, you know, not really in line with what Noble Jawali laid down. They are really against what Noble Jawali laid down, and they want you to be down with them being against the Prophet.
Yeah.
And then when negative stuff happens to you, they're not going to take any blame or whatever like that. They're going to point at somebody, say they did it. When it's really these agents, these backbiters, these people jealous of Noble Jawali's fame and nobility, they don't want to give him props, you know what I mean? But they want all the props for themselves. To make sure, like we said, you know what I mean? When you see Moors put Prophet up front on their stuff that they wrote, they put Noble Jawali up front, right? Their stuff that they wrote. They got Noble Jawali up front, they don't have their self. You know, you're going to see all these other books, people make themselves Noble Jawali on the cover of their book. Make themselves Noble Jawali, you know, put the sister on the ground and stuff like that. You know what I mean? Try to disguise this thing as theirs. When Prophet laid this down for Moors to have, you immediately know who they are. These wannabe agents will do anything to become agents. And they're like mindless, and their like-mindedness makes it easy for agents to reach anyone that they deem a threat to the system that has been constructed by the Matrix to keep the illusion going. So right now, you have good individuals. You have good individuals who love the Prophet, care about the Prophet or whatever, but some dirty Moor taught them. And now they're perpetuating, right, the wannabe agent, the wannabe COINTELPRO, wannabe FBI paper Moors, who are learning from some dirty Moors that's been in the FBI paper since 1930s or whatever like that, right? They have them now going out, pushing this fraud of, you know, well, oh yeah, well, you know, you have to be in the temple to be a Moor. You know? Yeah, I'm a Moor. Well, what temple you belong to? Well, who cares what temple I belong to? Like, I'm a Moor. Like, what's the issue? No, well, you can't say that you're a Moor because, you know, Temple 86 is the one that is the real Moor science temple that you have to belong to in order to say that you're a Moor. And they don't pay attention to, you know, we all got a fez, we all got a flag, we all hold up the prophet, we all say Islam, we all got, you know, hand on the chest or whatever like that, say Moorish American prayer, covenant of the Asiatic nation, everybody got a nationality card that they show, but you don't tell me I'm not what it is, right? Playing with people's birthright, always. The matrix of hip-hop, you know, the matrix of Moor science, right? So, you know, we're going to put this stuff together. The matrix of hip-hop is just that, an illusion. But our collective mind is being used by the matrix as a vessel to travel faster than the speed of light, bouncing off a similar program minds that enable them to appear everywhere and nowhere at once. The mental influence of these potential agents can be so strong that it can override one's natural instinct and ability to be free and think for themselves. So Noble Jawali told the Moors, think and save yourself. I brought you everything that it takes to save a nation. Take it and save yourself. But then they're going to listen to all these different people say stuff. You know, they hear stuff, oh yeah, that guy said, and that Moore said, and you know, just like the brother with the UCCs, you know, I mean, oh yeah, you know, UCC, I want to be free, so I'm going to do UCCs. You ever heard about Noble Jawali? Noble Jawali, who's that? I never heard about that guy before. So are you talking about UCCs and commerce? You ever heard about Moors? No, what are you talking about? So you're talking about commerce and you're talking about trademarking this and all this type of stuff and you don't even know the basic stuff? Obviously, somebody's playing you. Obviously. Right? You too can be short-circuited and reprogrammed if you're not extremely careful of who or what media channels you interface with regarding real hip-hop in the year 2006. Remember, the agents are everywhere. So if you love real hip-hop and your cover is blown, then you are in grave danger. The matrix will stop at nothing to make sure that every quote-unquote black male from the age of 8 to 40 years old dresses alike, thinks alike, listens to the same music, and adheres to the same way of life. The matrix will stop at nothing to ensure that every black female feels degraded, worthless, and that the black male is her primary enemy. However, you are different. The mere fact that you have rejected the programming that has turned 99% of our youth into hip-hop drones means that you are an anomaly with the capacity to retain the strand of original hip-hop within your DNA. Right? So you're special. Knowing that, hey, I have a prophet, Noble Jawali, he said certain stuff. I'm going to just read what he said and use that as the template to judge anybody else who says that they're Moors. I'm not going to use this guy's whatever he said. Because half those people, like we said, are agents working for the democracy to keep the people in a state of continually feeding that so that that can prosper. And people looking at this could keep saying, what do the Moors got? How come the Moors don't have hospital? How come the Moors don't have schools? How come the Moors, the Jews have this? And these guys have this. How come the Moors don't have nothing? Like I was telling somebody the other day, how come the Moors don't have nothing? Because half these Negro, Black, colored people out here sold out the Moors. Because they know and they're not telling. Why? Because they're agents working for the democracy. There's Moors in turbans and fezes with nationality card. They got Moroccan flag in their house and all that. That are against this. So it's That's why Drawley said, study, study, study. When you study yourself. There's only going to be a handful saved. I'm going to have fingers left over. All that stuff. Letting you know how much agents there are. How much sellouts there are in this. How much people took checks in order to make sure that we don't get to that level where we were. Because remember, go back and check the records. You know, Moore's aren't going to, you know, put it like that. Right? Moore's aren't going to put it like that. But there was manufacturing companies in the Moorish movement during Noble Drawley's time. People weren't working for no Europeans that were Moors. They were working for Moorish manufacturers, Moorish businesses. They were entrepreneurs. Children were learning in the temple about starting their own business. As children, they were learning that. Back then. But then, you know, come back to today, all these temples out here, and you know, half these temples, they're not teaching these things. They're not teaching what needs to be learned. They're teaching what could be parodied. They're teaching what people could just, you know, flap at the gum, sound, you know what I mean, intelligent, whatever like that. You know, they got some knowledge, but then they're paying this hybrid taxes, right, in their own land, right?
Super scam.
In other words, you still have access to your detailed files about a time in hip-hop when the gods ruled. It means that you are immune to every radio station, hip-hop magazine, and video show that attempts to erase your memory or scramble your DNA structure in an effort to close the gateway between hip-hop's past and hip-hop's future. It means that by the Matrix standards, you are the one. And with an active pineal gland that can clearly see beyond the illusion that is the construct, you are more dangerous than a million of its agents. So we, Moorish Americans, you know, that's why we bring up the thing about Moabite. And a Moabite being 1,000 bailiffs. One Moabite is equal to 1,000 bailiffs. So no more could say that, oh yeah, well, you know, I'm more in this jurisdiction by myself and I don't have anybody. You're 1,000 people. That's your physical. We're talking about your higher self. How much people is your higher self? What does your higher self equal in people? If you have nationality and you're clear in your mind, if you can manifest your higher self in physical form, how many people is that going to be? One? I doubt that's going to be one. Just like you're saying, we, with an open pineal gland, are more dangerous than a million agents. Moors who put the profit up front. Moors who put the profit up front. Moors who recognize what nationality and birthright is more dangerous than a million dirty Moors trying to convince you that, you know, this is a religious movement and go pray to Allah for a profit and all those foolishness like that, right? Everybody try to stop what this is, what we're about. Everybody try to stop it, and they can't stop it. They never will stop it, right? It's never going to be something that they stop, because these are a different breed of Moors that are around right now. These aren't the same Moors that, you know, took this information and, you know, were, you know, humming, humming with it, don't know what to do with it or whatever. Moore's taking this and they're exercising. Right? We're gonna, and then, like we said, that was Hip Hop Decoded. Make sure you go pick this up. You know, don't even sleep on it because it says black people in there. Don't get it twisted. This is where it's at right here. Right? Hip Hop Decoded. Gonna go to another one. You know? It's a little school book vibes. You know? One of those little school book vibes, big writing inside so anybody could read it or whatever. Right? Some Malcolm enchanted the media. He laughed with them as he enthusiastically answered their questions. He called them by their first names. Reporter Peter Goldman was at the Park Sheridan Off conference and remembers the surprise of one of the woman reporters from a local television station. "He's so charming," exclaimed the reporter. "So intelligent." Some of his positions appeared to have softened, and Malcolm now made efforts to bring himself closer to the civil rights movement. But there seemed to be plenty of bad blood from the past remaining. He did not hear much from movement leaders who might have also feared him as a competitor. Regardless of the opinion of others, Malcolm was listening and learning from influences around him. He told a newspaper man that he was reading an awful lot now to catch up on what he'd missed while in the nation. So he knew that when he was in the nation, that he wasn't learning crap in there. And he started catching up on stuff, right? Because why? They were playing leash on him. They were playing, you have to follow the tenets of the order of the stuff and that, and you know, you can't do your own thing. You can't read this. You have to read this only, and that's all. Right? You think Drew Ali said study, 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 and that just means Holy Quran and Divine Constitution and 101s, and that's it? Right? Regardless of the opinion of others, Malcolm was listening and learning from influences around him. He told a newspaper man that he was reading an awful lot now and catching up with what he'd missed while in the nation. As he had before in his life, he was again transforming himself. Near the end of the march, he met his longtime rival Martin Luther King for the first time and only time. The two men encountered each other in a hallway in the U.S. Capitol building after King's news conference on March 26. They were friendly towards one another, and photographers pushed and shoved to get pictures of the two men shaking hands. Remember, that's Professor X and Magneto. Right? Right? So remember the X-Men trilogy? Last one that just dropped, when they're finally together or whatever, about to take over stuff. You know what I mean? None of this stupid, you know, against each other. We're all X-Men. There's not no good X-Men, bad X-Men. The same dog that bit you, bit me. What are we fighting for? Why don't we just unite this thing, right? And do some damage right now, right? Because of Malcolm's public attacks on King, people always pitted the men against one another, right? Same thing, right? And they'll tell you that that's what X-Men was about, right? Malcolm X and Magneto. Malcolm X and Martin Luther King, mm-hmm. Professor X and Magneto.
That's about.
Right? That they're, you know, putting against each other when they're best friends or whatever like that. You know what I mean? Right? Making each a representative of different ways to make change, peacefully or violently. Right? Professor X, peace man. Mm-hmm. You know, Magneto, you know, mm-hmm. Let's deal with these people's cases because they have to get dealt with. You know what I mean? Well, no, you know, it's nonviolence and this march, we shall overcome and all that type of stuff. And man's like, forget the singing crap. You know what I mean? Let's bust some heads or whatever. All right? Many thus think that the two men were enemies. In fact, each was concerned with what the other was thinking, and each greatly admired the other. The observation is maintained by author Alex Haley, who in early 1964 was working with Malcolm on his autobiography. Haley would travel to the South for a King interview, who would casually ask after an hour or so what Malcolm was saying about him lately. Back in New York, Haley would be asked by Malcolm what King had said about him. I'm convinced, wrote Haley, that privately the two men felt mutual admiration and respect. And that's why they killed them. Because just like Garvey and Drew Ali, they were about to do this. And if they did this, it would have been over. Civil rights would have been done. Because Malcolm was humanitarian now, going to the UN and all this, right? King, we've been to the mountaintop, being the Mason, you know, seen the promised land, right? And knew that this stuff is about to, this we're about to take over this thing right here, right? We're about to take this thing over. And what happened? Get them out the way. So it can't happen. That unification can't happen, right? Take Marcus Garvey, deport him ASAP. After Noble Drew Ali visited him, nationalized him, told him, yo, when you come out, because they're gonna let you out after I came, come check you. Guarantee they're gonna let you out. You're gonna go tell all these Garveyites or whatever. Forget that Negro BS that you've been telling them. You guys are going to join the Morris Science Temple of America, and then we're going to do like this. And then if they did like that, because, you know, we know Malcolm, Martin, whoever else, all these people knew who Marcus Garvey was, honored him, respected him, whatever, for what he did for, you know, the black people and all that stuff. So it wouldn't have, it's not far-fetched that this thing was over. Everybody would have been Moors. Everybody. And the purpose was to stop that. And then you have Moors today pushing unity with black guys. Pushing unity with Hebrew guys. Pushing unity with Nuwapian guys. And unity with all these people who calling there something that they're not. When all those people should just say that they're Moors. Just say that you're Moors. And let's be done with the games. Stop the nonsense. Let's just say that we're Moors. And have these people that took the position of saying that they're Moors, you know, they don't want to rock the boat. They don't want to challenge the status quo. Slave and citizen, the Negro in Americas, in the Americas, Frank Tatenbaum. Couple pages here. The Negro slave arriving in the Iberian Peninsula in the middle of the 15th century found a propitious environment, the setting, legal as well as moral, that made this easy transition possible was due to the fact that the people of the Iberian Peninsula were not strangers to slavery. The institution of slavery, which had long since died out in the rest of Western Europe, had here survived for a number of reasons, especially because of the continuing wars with the Moors, which lasted until the very year of the discovery of America. At the end of the 15th century, there were numerous slaves in Portugal and Spain, and especially in Andalusia, among them not only Negroes, but Moors, Jews, and apparently Spaniards as well. In spite of his full powers over his slaves, the master might neither kill nor injure him unless authorized by the judge, nor abuse him against reason or nature, nor starve him to death. But if the master did any of these things, the slave could complain to the judge, and if the complaint were verified, the judge must sell him, giving the price to the owner, and the slave might never be returned to the original master. Any Jewish or Moorish slave became free upon turning Christian, and even if the master himself later became Christian, he recovered no rights to his former slave. A Christian slave living among the Moors might return to live among the Christians as a free man. The slave could appeal to the courts, one, if he had been forced by will and testament, and the document maliciously hidden under these circumstances, he could appeal against anyone holding him. Two, if the slave had money from another and entrusted it to someone for the purpose of being bought from his master and given his liberty, and if then this person refused to carry out the trust by refusing either to buy him or free him if he had bought him. And three, if he had been bought with the understanding that he would be freed on the receipt of the purchase price from the slave and refused either to accept the money or to release him after accepting it. And in that, just keep in mind, 12 years a slave, buying the slavery or buying yourself free, you know, call somebody over there, hey, you know, I know a man over there or whatever, he knows that I'm not, you know, could you get him the message or whatever, and then tell him, come get me, blah, 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 right? Or, like Django, the German, going, you know, I'm looking for, you know, a guy named Django, yeah, I know somebody named Django or whatever like that, yeah, okay, well, you know, here's, you know, whatever, I want to buy him from you, sorry, no, we're not selling him, all right, well, blow your head off. I'm going to take him from you. Here's the guns. You guys do whatever you want to do with this last guy right here. And we're going to keep it moving as we should because, you know, we're free. Right? So we have the ability to get our people. You know, we have the ability to get our people. We have the ability to change this thing around. But Moors have to want to do that. And then I wanted to put this out there for the UK Moors. For the UK Moors, see if you could find this one. Russia and the Negro, Blacks in Russian History and Thought. Just so you can know that you've been out there. It's not anything new. No. Abzi Abdul Ogli, brother from Russia, clearly brother from Russia, right? General Abraham Hannibal, raised as a favorite servant of Peter the Great, he was the great-great-grandfather of writer Alexander Pushkin. Another brother there. You see his little regalia and stuff like that, so you know that he had a prestigious position. He wasn't just some nigger over there, right? He wasn't just, you know, the guy in the back, you know, the servant. You know, when they show the pictures, you know, a guy in the back it's of the European.
The he's not the back guy.
He's not the back guy. Right? Yeah, right? He's not the back guy. Okay? The writer Alexander Pushkin included his own African heritage among his literary subjects. Clearly, you could see the, you know, the little features and you know his hair and stuff like that. You know what I mean? Some European guy, you know. Countess Samolova and her foster daughter, one of the important Russian artists of the early 19th century, Karl Brulov. And then keep in mind that, you know, It's not like Pushkin or the general or whatever, you know, the little blackamoor in the back like this one. You know, we're talking about people who had positions. You know what I mean? People who had positions. Negro Boy picture, right? By Konstantin Makovsky, you know. Find me a Negro that wears a turban. I don't know. Negroes don't really wear turbans and stuff like that. You know what I'm saying? But a Negro boy with a turban, you know, so they say. You know what I mean? They're making their claim. You know, trying to get jurisdiction.
That's the picture,
Chief. You know? Ukrainian poet Taras Shevchenko, Taras Shevchenko. Clearly, you know, this is Ukrainian now, right? Ukrainian brother. No, and then again, you know, look at the dress code. You know, I mean, you already know that he was distinguished. He wasn't some Negro. You know, just like Brother Dawid was talking about in the Skype, how they changed Stanley Lane Poole's book from Moors in Spain to Muslims in Spain, you know, to hide you, because you know they can't just put it out there. I mean. You know, we put it out there, we just might take over again. They do not want that. They do not want that. But this was an interesting one. So they show you the Statue of Liberty, right? They show you the Statue of Liberty, okay? But then the crown of the statue. The crown of the statue is really our fam, you know. Remember, they might talk crap or whatever. They might say this, burn crosses on people's land, but remember that they were dressing up as Moors. Brother Dawid showed that too in the lecture from the weekend, right? That not only Klansmen dress up in the hooded stuff. Not only Klansmen. The colonizers, he isn't yet mature enough for independence. He isn't yet mature enough for independence, right? Who's not mature? Minorities are not mature, but this is a grown man. But why are they talking about not being mature when this is a grown man right here? Because they know, everybody knows, that us classifying ourselves as minority, right, is why we're not ready yet. Us calling ourselves things that we're not is why we're not ready yet. Okay? Laying it down. This was a good read too. We have some stuff in here. That's Russia and the Negro. You can go hunt that one down. Manly P. Hall, The Secret Destiny of America. the unknown who swayed the signers of the Declaration of Independence. Faced with the death penalty for high treason, courageous men debated long before they picked up the quill pen to sign the parchment that declared the independence of the colonies from the mother country. For many hours they had debated in the State House at Philadelphia, with the lower chamber doors locked and a guard posted, when suddenly a voice rang out from the balcony, a burst of eloquence to the keynote. God has given America to be free, ended with the delegates rushing toward to sign. What rushing forward to sign? The American patriots then turned to express their gratitude to the unknown speaker. The speaker was not in the balcony. He was not to be found anywhere. How he entered and left the locked and guarded room is not known. No one knows to this day who he was. They know who it was. It was Ben Bay, Benjamin Banneker, you know, the Moor that taught all these hybrids what law was, taught them that they have to sign the parchment if they want to be free, right? They have to do what? Declare their independence from whoever was ruling them. The only way that you're going to be free is to declare your independence. And they went on, declared their independence, and now, you know, here they are, ruling over Moors, who don't know that they're Moors, calling themselves Negro, Black, all this other BS that they think is identities and whatever like that, you know. We'll actually close out with some more Nobuju Ali again, just because, you know, why not? The Prophet has spoken, and once the Prophet speaks, you know, Moors take heed. Think this over, you Moors. Nobuju Ali laid it all out. And all these Moors playing like he didn't say stuff, you know, like he didn't have Moors under manners. He had Moors under serious manners. Think this over, you Moors. All sheiks, grand sheiks, must prepare for the Prophet before he comes to visit them. Must see to it that all is clean and in perfection, as far as comfort is possible, or otherwise don't arrange to have his presence. Real simple. Stuff better be in order when Prophet comes, or don't even tell him come. All members should pay from 25 cents to 50 cents weekly towards the emergency fund. Now remember, 25 cents to 50 cents weekly, that was gold and silver. You know what I mean? That wasn't fiat dollars. This was before 1933 when they started bringing in the fiat debt notes and all that stuff. So think about all these members paying their 25 cents, 50 cents. That's just the emergency fund. We're not even talking about the dues fund. We're not talking about, you know, all the other stuff that Moors were putting finance to, that Nobuju Ali told Moors put finance to, so he can shove aside the discord that's facing the nation. They're just emergency fund. 25 to 50 cents a week back then, right, is big. This fund will increase so that will soon amount to the grand sum of $1,000. That is if you are loyal Moors. That is if you are loyal Moors. You can't save that now. The emergency fund goes to the bank. The treasurer will tend to the responsibility of seeing that the money is in the bank. Yes, and under the name of Moral Science Temple of America Finance. That way nobody can touch it. Why? Because it's for the Moors. The emergency fund for the Moors. If something happened to you, the emergency fund we can go to take out whatever we need in order to assist Moors that have been loyal to the Prophet. Same reason why today we tell Moors, make sure that you put your little whatever so that you can't say that, you know, you can't be helped when you're in adversity because you put to the fund. You can't say that we can't seal your documents because you paid your dues. You can't say that, no, we're not going to do whatever because, oh, check the record. Oh, yeah, dues up today. Well, you know, sorry, you know. We got to give you your stuff. Right. When needed, act according to the law pertaining to the procedure of performing an emergency act. No head of any said temple is to borrow from any member more than $5 to $10 unless by notification of the Prophet. The necessity for the loan. When any said temple desires to purchase property, they must first notify the grand body or the Prophet, and it must be purchased under the name of the Morris Science Temple of America or Noble Juali. An individual name should never be applied. I, Noble Juali, am responsible for all finance. So therefore, let I, the Prophet, know what is on me. Some of you Moors have slipped and slipped drastically. So you had better lace up your shoes before I get there. Everything, every business transaction, or anything pertaining to finance is to be transacted in the name of the Moor Science Temple of America or Noble Juali. We Moors must maintain a grand treasury. No, where's that? Where'd that go? Where's the grand treasury at? You know, these are the questions that we should be asking. Instead of asking, Grand Sheikh, you know, how do we interpret the Quran and is it part and parcel or is it partial or is it whatever like that? How about asking these people who've been the head of the movement for 80 years, haven't done nothing with this, where did the Grand Treasury disappear to? And if there was a Grand Treasury, obviously there was something in there. You're not going to have an empty treasury. Where's all the stuff that was in the treasury? Obviously, they're not going to have any answers. They'll probably kick you out of the temple or whatever like that, tell you, you know, you're violating, you know, something. Right? We Moors must maintain a grand treasury, just as in the days of our forefathers. Then you are a nation. Until then, you are nothing. This is what these Moors did to your stuff. The emergency fund is issued by no book, but by an emergency card punched according to contribution, then marked on the book. That is the law. And the law must live. The government is behind me, and I must get behind you. For I must uphold and enforce the law. My mission is to save you Moors. The heads of all temples, grand sheikhs, grand sheikhs, must confirm to the divine principles, love, truth, peace, freedom, and justice. They must live the life among the members and be loved even as the Prophet is loved. They must not practice the principle of segregation among any group in his or her temple. Let it be he or she that is head of any temple of the Morris Science Temple of America, that if there should come any grievance that cannot be settled by the head, notify the Prophet at once. You know, that could still be done today. But remember, he's on the soul plane, he's not nowhere. Don't think that, you know, don't think that Prophet is non-existent. Remember, look up juridic person so you can know that Noble Juali is still around today. And he knows where every member is along the way. So don't think you could pull fast ones, you know what I mean? And Prophet's not going to see because he's not here. No, Prophet's here watching everything that's going down. So all you Moors, lace up your stuff because you don't want to get what Prophet has to offer for dirty Moors. Stay out of that lane. No member is to attend Adept Chamber that has not lived a moral and clean life and has not paid his or her dues or assessments, providing that he or she is working or able, cannot consider himself a Moor. But traders must be excluded from the books after having a fair trial by the head of their temple, and that must be sent to the grand body. And all members that are able to subscribe towards the uplifting fund, because it takes finance to uplift the nation, and those that are able and fail to act are not Moors but traitors to their cause and trust and their nation, and are not allowed to share all of the Moorish honors. Put that one out there again. And those that are able and fail to act are not Moors but traitors to their cause and trust and their nation, and are not allowed to share all the Moorish honors. And the penalty is, it is embezzlement of the faith of our creed. All heads of all temples must observe these laws by the prophet. So Nobodrawli didn't play with traitors. He didn't play with dirty Moors. Oh yeah, like dirty Moors. Oh yeah, unity, you know what I mean? So, you know, we'll give dirty Moors a pass or whatever like that. So, you know, we can have unity amongst the Moors. Forget that crap. We don't play with traitors and dirty Moors. We already know, you know, traitors must be excluded from the books after having a fair trial. The fair trial is, if your name's in the FBI papers, we don't need you around here. It's love to all the Moors. Peace, love, truth, peace, freedom, justice, all the divine principles that Nobodrawli laid down for the Moors. Islam to all the Moors worldwide, all the Moors in the chat, honors to you, all the Moors that have put out literature, all the Moors that have websites, all the Moors that have a newspaper, all the Moors that have some type of business related to Moors, all the Moors who have a business and they're using their business to teach Moors, put Moors onto Moor science, whatever, all the Moors out there who study, all the Moors out there who have libraries at their house, all the Moors who study civics and religion, all the Moors who see that this is a divine and national movement, not just a divine movement, or not just a national movement, all the Moors who honor the Prophet Nobodrawli, all the Moors who know that Allah is feminine, not masculine, all the Moors who recognize that it's all about us getting sisters this information so they can take their place amongst the elite and get this movement moving in the right direction, because you know sisters will make brothers do some stuff, because you know sisters, just, you know, they make brothers do some stuff, right? Islam to all the master teachers. Islam to all the young Moors that's coming in with their eyes wide open, seeing and knowing. Islam to all the Moors who says, forget that, we don't want to be part of Moor Science Temple or whatever like that, but we'll have a study group or we'll have a whatever. Islam to all the Moors who are Moor Science Temple that recognize what this is and they're living according to what the Prophet laid down. Islam to all the Moors who recognize all the fraud going on and they want to see something better for the future generation. And Islam to all the Moors who knows and recognizes that this is nationhood. This is not clubism. This is not come join the clique of Moors that have, you know, orange fezes and pink tassels and stuff like that. And can't forget Islam to everybody who supports, right, completely supports this. And they'll risk everything that they got to make sure that the next generation has this information for free. And they're not charging people for their nationality and birthrights. And we also have to say, once again, you know, this is Northwest of Mexum, but we know that Moors are waking up internationally. So all the Moors on the other side of the Atlantic, peace and love to you. Continue to study. You know we're here. We're going to be doing this forever. You know what I mean? We're going to rise and close out with the prayer. Don't forget to support all the Moors that are doing active work. And connect with them so they can do more active work. And remember, we don't play traitors, dirty Moors, and all those. You know what I mean? As soon as you see them cast a stone, scimitar, butt, something, let them know that we don't play those ones. Five on the left, two on the right. A lot of Father of the Universe, Father of love, truth, peace, freedom, and justice, allow my protector, my guide, and my salvation by night and by day through his holy prophet, Noble Juwali, Islam Ashe. Don't forget 9:30, blogtalkradio.com/MHHS-eyes-wide-open. 9:30 this Thursday, Sons of Allah, 9 p.m., blogtalkradio.com/MHHS-eyes-wide-open. This Saturday at Morris Science Temple of America, 1 p.m., we have our fifth installment of Moorish History Month with Sister Sila Bey, going in on some etymology, astrology, and the rest of all that good stuff that sis is studying and, you know, putting more onto game. And Sunday at 2467 Eglinton Avenue, we're going to be having the Skype with Brother Mizraim L. And also, before the Skype, we're going to be shooting the new Iron Sheet video. So be on the lookout for that. We're going to be starting shooting at 11 a.m. until lecture time. So any Moors that are in Canaan land that you want to, you know, come out to the video shoot, you know what I mean, by 1206 Studios, feel free to pop in, you know what I mean. If you don't want to stay for the lecture, it's cool, you know, you want to just come for the video shoot, leave, whatever, like that, whatever, you know. But don't forget 9:30, tune in live and direct. The contact number for you to call in, because you know it shuts off at 11:30, the internet feed shuts off, and all we're going to be doing is being on the phone. So make sure you call in early, 347-945-5899. Moorish Heritage and History School, Eyes Wide Open. Peace, Moors, Islam.